गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, माय नेम इज डॉक्टर सुनील दत्त एंड प्रेजेंटली आई एम वर्किंग एज प्रोफेसर एंड हेड इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एजुकेशन एंड एजुकेशन मैनेजमेंट एट दिस इंस्टीट्यूट. बेसिकली आई एम ए साइंस पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट, डिड माय एमएससी ऑनर्स इन केमिस्ट्री, देयर आफ्टर शिफ्टेड टू एजुकेशन, डिड माय पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन एंड पीएचडी इन एजुकेशन फ्रॉम पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी चंडीगढ़. And after working for about 2.5 years in industries, I joined teaching profession as a lecturer in a college of education and taught for 7 years to postgraduate students. I joined NITTR Chandigarh in 1992 and became professor of education in 2011. And I have also worked as the professor in charge of academic cell for about 12 years. And to my credit, there are 37 PhD students who have completed their PhD dissertation under my supervision, and 8 more students are pursuing their PhD program. I am also the coordinator of one massive open online course, that is development of self-learning material, and co-coordinating 2 other massive open online courses, one on research in technical education and second is on institutional management and administrative procedure. Now going to the present topic, that is understanding learning and learners. Why?
Sorry to interrupt you, sir, kindly move this box which is in this participant box is there. It's covering your slide, sir. Kindly move it to the right, sir.
So you see, the broad objective of any educational program is or endeavor is to promote learning among learners, and any program is nothing without learners. But if we do not understand our learners and their needs, very little learning will take place. Learners who join our technical education system either with 10 or 10 plus 2 qualification bring with a changed set of knowledge, skills and attitude brought about as a result of learning experiences provided to them during the course of instruction. But as you know, no two individuals are alike. Individuals interpret events in terms of their experiences, intelligence, personality, cognitive style, creativity, self-concept, gender, age, etc. and thereby may perceive, interpret and evaluate the same learning event in different ways. So an understanding of the learner and their individual differences can help the teacher in providing relevant and appropriate learning experiences to learners in order to produce desired learning. So now the question is, how do I meet the needs of all learners when their needs and talents vary so greatly? Because in a classroom, we have learners with different needs, with different talent, with different intelligence. So we face this kind of situation in a classroom. So diversity has become the norm among the students in the classrooms of today. We have students with different language background, family background, cultural background, economics and experiential background. So students' diversity in terms of their aptitude, their achievement, their interest, their needs, motivation, student engagement, their ability, their personality, age, gender and preferred ways of learning. And the characteristics of today's learners are very well known to all of you, that they are tech savvy, they rely on search engine. Whenever they want some information, they quickly access to search engine. They are interested in multimedia, it means they are not interested in talk and talk only. They create internet content, they are visually literate, they engage in face-to-face interaction, they seek feedback immediately, and they also pressurize themselves to succeed. They are experimental, experiential, kinesthetic, use trial, and error, multitasking, but they have got short attention span on one activity. They prefer teamwork. They are emotionally open. They go for gratification instantly and they respond very quickly. So motivation, motivating and engaging student, because most students, they when join the institution, they arrive with lot of excitement and they are ready to engage with their chosen courses. Sometimes, however, along the way, they are discouraged and lose interest and motivation to continue with their studies. So this loss of engagement can be due to internal conditions like health, lack of confidence, poor self-esteem, poor management, time management skill, because of loneliness, because some students, they join other cities for some program. And these could be due to external conditions like the course structure, the teacher dissatisfaction, or they have got poor grades and any number of other distractions. As teachers, we need to acknowledge and emphasize their initial interest and motivation to learn and help them to maintain it through to completion of their course. You see, when you begin your lecture with one remark that today I am going to talk to you about this thing, today I will teach, today I will discuss, because you have not gained their attention. So they will say, sir, this is your headache, please go and take your head. So in order to motivate them, you need taking a new topic. Once they are interested in the need of that particular topic, they would like to give their attention to your input. So individuals are motivated by different forces, but some essential influences on student motivation and engagement are course design that addresses the needs and expectations of students, or teaching that inspires and rewards commitment and restates the purpose of study, recognizing student individuality and diversity. They are given opportunities to work in team, timely and effective feedback from teachers and other students. Because what is feedback? Feedback is knowledge of results. Say one student has answered the question very correctly, then the teacher must reinforce his response by saying, Ramesh ji, you have said very rightly, okay, or your answer has some shortcoming, okay, so you have to give. So they are very active rather than passive learner in this context. The concept of surface and deep learning. You see, individual students react differently to any given learning situation. Some students stand back and attempt to uncritically rote learn whatever is presented by the teacher, because a teacher has simply pour the information into the minds of students without relating with the examples, or without showing some of the visuals, or by giving certain tasks. Others may look for the deeper meaning of the interaction and see how it fits with what they know. So they will challenge what is presented critically and ask questions. This is called deep learning. This happens in every class. Now, brain research has confirmed what teachers have always known, that no two learners are alike. No two learners learn in the identical way. And enrich, you see, if I give you some tool for knowing your learning style, you will find that each of you might have different learning styles. So an enriched environment for one learner is not necessarily enriched for another. Likewise, what acts as a reinforcer for one learner may not be for another learner. So in the classroom, we should teach learners to think for themselves. Now coming to differentiated instruction. Actually, it is a teaching philosophy based on the premise that teachers should adapt instruction to student differences. Teachers should modify their instruction to meet students' varying readiness levels. varied learning preferences and varied interests. Now, what is what does differentiating instruction mean? It is not individualizing instruction for students. It is providing instruction to meet the varied range of students' needs. It is not assigning all students the same activities, but it is using varied strategies that address students' readiness, interest, and learning styles. Differentiating instruction is not using the same instruction material for all students, but it is using varied resources for varied learners. It is not teaching from the text cover to cover. Actually, it is using the text as a resource while teaching big ideas and critical concepts. Differentiated instruction is not assessing all students' learning in the same way. Okay, it means different assessment techniques need to be used for assessing the varied learning abilities of the student. So differentiating instruction is using multiple means of assessment. Multiple choice question, short answer question, you can say there are a variety of techniques of assessment. We have one session so wherein we will talk about different techniques of assessment. Differentiating instruction is not limiting learning experiences to the classroom environment only. It is promoting learning across various settings. It could be home, it could be institution, it could be community. So now let us have a look at the concept of learning. Actually, learning is a relatively permanent change in the behavior of learner. And this change occurs as a result of successful or unsuccessful learning, isn't it? So, you see, it is it means acquiring knowledge, skill, and attitude. It is relatively permanent. Why? Because if someone forgets the information immediately, we cannot say learning has taken place. It is a relatively permanent change. That is, it should exist for a fairly good amount of time. And if someone is confined to some environment, or you can say where there is no interaction, okay, someone is confined to a situation where there is no environment, so can we say that learning will take place? No. It means learning occurs as a result of interaction with the environment. So Gaine has defined it as a change in human disposition or capability which persists over a period of time and which is not simply ascribable to the process of growth. Now let us have a look at the characteristics of learning. Learning is a dynamic process. It is not static, and it is an active process. It is not a product. So learning involves all those experiences and training of an individual which produce changes in his or her behavior. And friend, learning is always purposeful. Learning is always goal directed. If you are learning something, it means there is some goal behind it. And you see, in today's context, because from NBA point of view, you have to demonstrate the learning outcomes, what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction or after the end of the course. So what are the program outcomes? So it is purposeful and goal-oriented. And another is that it prepares an individual for any adjustment or any adaptation that may be necessary. And it is universal. It is a continuous process. Okay. instead of change in existing behavior or acquisition of new behavior, learning may also result in discontinuance or abandonment of existing behavior. So learning does not include changes in behavior on account of maturation, on account of fatigue, or on account of illness or drug, because these changes are purely transitory in nature and are quite unstable. So as and when the factor causing change is removed or restored, the behavior may revert to its original form. Now, let us learn the elements of the learning event. These elements that constitute the learning event have been identified by Garnier in 1983. Firstly, in any complex situation, it is the learner. So this is the first element, very essential element. The learner who must interpret the stimulus, differentiate and combine them and give them some meaning. Another is the stimulus or the stimuli situation. So any stimulus or set of stimuli to which the learner is sensitive can become a part of the learning situation. So more learning is likely to take place if the learning situation is rich in potential stimulation. The third element of learning event is the internal condition. These are also necessary because perception, your cognitive structure, self-concept, attitude, needs, motive, even previous learning, recall of prerequisites, all affect the learning. Recall of prerequisites. Say, you have assumed that your students are familiar with some concept for taking up the new topic. But without testing their prerequisites, you start teaching the new topic, then you cannot guarantee that your student would attend to your lecture. It means as a teacher, you need to ensure that they possess the prerequisites necessary for beginning a new topic. And there is the response. So any action or reaction to a situation constitute response variables or overt behavior. Stages of learning, very important. Learning begins with the presentation of a stimulus. So for the perception of the stimulus, learner needs to be motivated before he pays attention to the particular stimulus. That is why I said that before coming to the topic, you need to build the rationale. Okay, for example, the topic is laws of inertia, and first of all, you need to know their level of prerequisite. You can show some object, placing it on the table, you can ask what is the position of this object. They will definitely say that it is at rest. On switching on the fan, another person can be asked, what is the position of the fan? They will say that it is in motion. Now, this object is lying on the table, it is at rest. How can we bring it into motion? Definitely, they will say that by pushing or by pulling, that object can be put into motion. Wonderful. You will have to say, moving bus. And the driver suddenly applies brakes, what happens? They will say, sir, we go forward. And what happens when the driver suddenly starts the bus? They say, we go back. Why are these due to? Now, this is a topic for a student of class 6. He or she has already learned the concept of rest, motion and force and have the previous experiences while traveling in a bus. But the reason is not known to him or her. Then you say that these are due to laws of inertia. So today, in this session, we will learn laws of inertia, and then you give an overview of your lecture on the left-hand side of the chalkboard. So this is how you are motivating the students. So For the perception of the stimulus, learner needs to be motivated before he pays attention to the particular stimulus. Now, it is possible for the attentive learner to associate the stimulus with the cognitive structure which is already available to him. And this is called as perception. And any information perceived by the individual has to be retained for a longer period of time if it is, it has to be used for solving a problem in a new situation, that is transferable learning. And this becomes possible only when the individual is able to retrieve the relevant information from his memory store. So it means during the classroom teaching, you have to give certain exercises for solving that will help them retain the knowledge, and you will also give them some you can say assignment for the homework. And if he or she is able to retrieve the information, relevant information, then it means he will be able to retain the knowledge for a longer period of time. Now, before proceeding further, let us have a look at various types of learning. Gagne has classified learning into five. The intellectual skills. These are the ways a person acquires for interacting with the environment through symbols. So these include multiple discrimination, concept learning can be concrete learning or defined learning, rule learning, and problem solving. The verbal information, which is organized into bodies of meaningful, interconnected facts and generalizations by an individual, and becomes the knowledge possessed by him or her, verbal information. Other are the cognitive strategies that are internally organized skills that govern an individual's own learning, remembering, and thinking behavior. Motor skills, that is neuromotor skills, which are the learned capabilities that underlie the performance. So much practice is needed for enhancing. And another very important is the attitude, which is an evaluated statement, either favorable or unfavorable, concerning any event. If I say I like this subject, that reflects my attitude towards that particular subject. Okay. Now, let us compare the characteristics of the adult learners and youth learners, because the learner who joins our institution is most of the time a youth learner. But over the period of time, he becomes an adult. So adult learner is problem-centered, seek educational solutions to where they are compared to or where they want to be in life. Whereas youth learner is subject-oriented, adult learner is result-oriented, whereas youth learner is future-oriented. Adult learner is self-directed and typically dependent upon others for direction, whereas youth learner is usually dependent upon adults for any kind of direction. Adult learner is often skeptical about new information. That means that he or she is inclined to question the truth or the soundness of the accepted idea or fact. Whereas the youth learner is likely to accept new information without trying it out or seriously questioning out. Adult learners seek education that relates or applies directly to their perceived need, whereas youth learners seek education that prepares them for an unclear future. Adult learners accept responsibility for their own learner. So it means, in short, we can say that for a student of final year, you need to consider him as him or an adult learner. You need to use them as resources for yourself and for others too. So these are the characteristics of adult learners and these are the teaching strategies. Because adults have years of experience and a wealth of knowledge, so use them as resources, use blended mode of learning, use open-ended questions to draw out students' knowledge and experiences, provide more opportunities for dialogue among students. Adults have established values, beliefs, and opinions, so take time to clarify students' expectation of the course, allow for any debate, or be careful to protect the minority opinions within the class. Adults expect to be treated as adults, so treat questions and comments with respect. Wonderful, you have said very rightly. Acknowledge their contributions to the class and do not expect them to necessarily agree with your plan for the course. And adults need to feel self-directed. So engage them in designing learning process, and flipped classroom is a wonderful technique for engaging their contribution in the classroom, because in a flipped classroom, we provide self-learning material, videos for learning at home, and in the classroom, actual problem solving is carried out. Adults often have a problem-centered approach to learning. So the teaching strategy is show immediately how new knowledge can be applied to current problems. So always try to relate the content with examples from life. So use participatory techniques like case studies, problem-solving groups, and flipped classroom. And adults tend to be less interested in surveys types of courses and more interested in straightforward how-to. So try to focus on theories and concepts and orient the course content toward the direct application rather than toward the theory. And adults have increased variation in learning style, so use a variety of teaching material and methods. So use blended mode of learning to vary your teaching strategy. Now, the key characteristics of a differentiated classroom. So if a student it is student centered, this differentiated classroom is student centered, like in flipped classroom and blended mode of learning, that is shifting the emphasis from the teacher and instruction to the student and learning. Focus means redefining the role of the teacher. So teacher centered is more appropriate when the learners are less mature, that is first year student, and lack prerequisites. Learner-centered works best when learners are relatively mature and possess significantly related knowledge, or where there is no particular sequencing or material. Now let me shift to the students' different thinking styles. So there are students who have reflective thinking style. So such students view new information subjectively, they relate new information to past experience, and they often ask why. And they examine their feelings about what they are learning. They are creative thinkers who are likely to play with new information. Say you can give them different, litmus paper, different assets and bases, and ultimately they will come to know that all assets turn blue litmus red and all bases turn red litmus blue. So they often play with new information, and they always ask why, and make excellent troubleshooters, create their own solutions and shortcuts. There are practical thinkers who want factual information without any nice to know additions. They seek the simplest, most efficient way to do their work, and they are not satisfied until they know how to apply their new skills to their job. And there are conceptual thinkers who accept new information only after seeing the big picture. And they want to know how things work, not just the final outcome. Now, coming to the learning style, very important part, because I would like to say visual learners, they are auditory learners. So visual learners process new information best when it is visually illustrated. So it means as a teacher, you need to give illustrations, show graphics, images, give demonstration, need to see the teacher's body language, prefer to take detailed notes to absorb the information. There are auditory learners. You see, they process new information best through listening. So them lecturing discussion or interpreting the underlying meanings of speech through listening to tone of voice, pitch, speed, retelling, and they benefit from reading the text loud. There are kinesthetic learners who process new information best by manipulation, by you guys are through moving, doing, touching, or actively participating. And for such individuals, they feel very hard to sit still for long periods and may become distracted by their need for some kind of activity and exploration. So you can use written assignments or ask them to take notes, or you can ask them to examine the objects, and you can ask them to participate in activities and so on. There are environmental learners who process new information best when it is presented in surroundings that match learner preferences, room temperature, lighting, seating, etc. So learners can control their own learning environment to a larger extent than on-campus students. Now, let me share some of the learning styles. You see, abundance of literature is available that has verified that each student learns in ways that are different from his or her peers. And several research studies have demonstrated that students can identify their own learning styles. And when exposed to a learning style, they believe they learn, students score higher on tests or cut knowledge, attitude, and so on. And therefore, it is advantageous to teach and test students in their preferred learning style. So research data has yielded at least 18 categories that learners are affected by their immediate environment, own emotionality, sociological needs, physical needs. Immediate environment. Now, sound. See, some learners can work easily with noise, that they can block out sound or ignore it, while others require complete silence before they can concentrate. So knowing this, you can understand how necessary it is to design an instructional environment that includes areas where students that need to make talk, interact, and share, and areas where others may work alone in quiet. Another is light. Another factor that appears to affect fewer people and does the sound. So although some students are light sensitive and can tolerate only subdued lighting, and others are light needy and require bright light before they can engage in reading or writing activities comfortably. Another is temperature. You see, individual reactions so temperatures are unique. Some people can concentrate better when the environment is cool. When it becomes warm, they feel cozy and can function well. Others cannot concentrate when they are cool. Anything other warm can cause physical or emotional discomfort and decrease. Okay. Another is the design. When you read or write something that requires effort, you find that you invariably migrate toward an easy chair, a lounge, a bed, or carpeting. That is, you require an informal design, one that is relaxed and casual, while for others, highly formal physical surroundings arouse motivation and creativity. Second one is own emotionality. Motivation is the hidden force that impels an individual to behave in a particular way. So as a teacher, you need to employ different strategies for motivating students with different needs. Then the persistence. Students should be given their objectives and a time interval in which to complete them with a clear understanding that although they need not continue their learning without pause, they need to complete the learning task. Responsibility. Every teacher recognizes and appreciates responsible students. Then need for structure or flexibility. Structure, you see, is the establishment of specific rules for working on and completing an assignment. It implies that certain things should be completed in a specific way within a definite time span. So it limits the number of options that are available. Then comes the sociological needs. Students learn in a variety of sociological patterns that include working alone, with one or two friends, with a small group, or as a part of a team with adults. So it is important to identify how each student learns and to then assign to that individual the correct grouping methods and resources. And finally, the physical needs. Firstly, the perceptual sense. Learners learn best through different senses. So some learn by touching, and that others require experiential or whole body experiences like kinesthetic in order to learn and to retain what is learned. Further, some learners learn best through a combination of two or more senses. Then comes intake. You see, many learners take periodic breaks when they study or focus on tasks that requires continued concentration. Some students drink cold drinks, others may smoke to become eye out for the students who are concentrating, bites on fingernails, pencils or other objects. So try to have 5 minutes break in between two sessions in a college so that they can go for they can fresh themselves. Then the mobility. Some students need a great deal of mobility in the learning environment and cannot function well unless permitted to vary their posture and location often. So you can provide them short assignments at different locations which will aid those students who need mobility to learn more effectively. Now I'll move to, because time is very less, I will request all of you that this test is available. Index of Learning Style test is available. This test is developed by Felder and Solomon, and this is an online test available freely. Please, once you get some time, it is about 20-25 minutes, and by this you will be able to identify your own learning styles. That is active learning style or reflective learning styles, and then you will also come to know if you are an active learner, how you can help yourself, and if you are a reflective learner, how you can help yourself. This is the interpretation is available online. Sensing learners or intuitive learners, that is which type of learner you are out of this combination, sensing learner, and how a sensing learner help themselves, and how can intuitive learners help themselves if the classroom situation does not provide them for doing that activity. Visual learner and verbal learners. So how can visual learners help themselves, and how a verbal learner can help himself? So this is available. So please go to this website by Felder and Solomon. Go to the Google, and this is an online test available. This test is for all age group level. Please respond to the 44 statements given in the questionnaire, and you will come to know your own learning style, and you will definitely agree with your own learning style and how you can help yourself. So now, let us have a look at certain principles of effective learning. Firstly, the teachers need to convey the learning outcomes to be achieved at the end of a particular course. learning outcome is nothing but a sentence or statement which describes what the learner will be able to do at the end of a unit of course. So these define what must be learned as to what instructional methods and media to be employed to reach desired learning level. And these also provide help to the teacher in planning the assessment procedures. The learning outcomes have been broadly classified into three domains: the cognitive domain, which is concerned with knowledge; the affective domain, which is concerned with attitude, interests, values, feelings; and psychomotor domain, which is concerned with hand and head coordination. So the teacher has to provide a mix of all the three: cognitive, affective, and psychomotor learning outcome while teaching in the classroom. Task analysis is a process of breaking down the complexity of an activity into easier steps. These steps are then taught to the students in a sequence one by one. So it means this is a very important principle of carrying out task analysis. So this will help you to know at which level you want to teach your student. For example, task analysis can be carried out for a topic from theory subject, or it can be carried out from the laboratory or the workshop. For example, this is the topic job of an engine mechanic. Now, these have been listed into five, you can say, duties: tuning the carburetor, adjusting the tappets, adjusting spark plug gap, changing engine oil, cleaning the spark plug. Now you can break down these further. For example, changing the engine oil. The task are jacking up the car, placing oil container under the sump, removing sump plug, allowing the oil to drain away. Likewise, you can classify all, break down all these into simpler. Now, jacking up the car. So the elements are acquiring right kind of jack, positioning the jack, manipulating the jack, and so on. So this principle will help you to break down the topic into its easier steps, and students are then presented those easier steps one by one in a particular sequence. So this will help them learn in a better way, and this will help them study the interrelationship between the sub topics in a particular topic. Another principle is meaningful. You see, meaningfulness. A student is likely to be motivated to learn things that are meaningful to him. So, in order to promote meaningfulness, you need to relate the content with examples from daily life or example from word of work. Another is prerequisites. A student is more likely to learn something new if he or she has all the prerequisites. So, as a teacher, whatever you have assumed for learning a new topic that students might be knowing, you need to assess their prerequisites by asking two questions, or you can give them an overview. So this will help them make them ready to receive your new topic. Novelty. A student is more likely to learn if his attention is attracted by relatively novel presentation, PowerPoint presentation, WebQuest learning, or say some YouTube links can be provided to them, or you can use a blended approach of learning, or employ flipped classroom for one or two topics. Another is, the student is more likely to learn if the presentation is structured so that the teacher's messages are open to the student inspection. So try to interact with the students in the language in which they can understand. See, if you are using a very difficult vocabulary, then they will not be able to understand the concept. So you see, our purpose is not to impress upon our student with the use of difficult vocabulary. Our purpose is to make the message clear, so speak in a very simple language. Like, you have to prepare the e-content, or you have to prepare the self-learning material. Please write the self-learning material or the e-content on a conversational mode or in an interactive language. That is when a student is reading the material, he will feel that a teacher is talking to him and not simply he is reading out the text. Questioning is another very important, you can say, principle of learning. So you need to ask the question on regular interval during teaching in a classroom. Likewise, you have prepared the e-content or self-learning material. Please insert practice tasks followed by feedback. Motivation is very important. Feedback is very important, and you need to provide appropriate practice. So the student is more likely to learn if he takes an active part in the practice geared to reach a learning outcome. So learning is effective when students are allowed to manipulate the learning material, respond to it, and get one part to another part, providing for stimulus variation. That is how to gain the attention of your students. You need to use various skills, and you need to cater to the individual differences in the classroom. Now I'll end here because the time topic is the time is not permitting me. So friend, now the session is open. If you have one or two quick questions, you can write in the chat box. You have said for checking types of learners. You see this, that Felder and Solomon, I'll write here that index of learning style, index of learning style by Solomon. This is available online. Please go through it, and you will be able to identify your learning style. And I would also suggest that whenever you go to your classroom, or since the students are now on an online mode, you can ask them to identify their learning styles and communicate to you, and you will come to know that there are students with varied learning styles, and it means you need to provide appropriate learning, you can say, experiences to meet the different learning styles of these students.
Sir, we have a hand raised by a participant. Can I unmute them, sir?
Please.
Dhaval Bhandari, I am unmuting you. Please go ahead with your question.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for unmuting, and thank you, sir, for a very fruitful session of this second session of our day one.
Sir, the second session I was very fast because time was very less, so yeah, I could give more example. But later on, in subsequent sessions, we'll give you more examples.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sure. I was actually out for lunch break, but still I had continued the session. So that I wanted to ask a few questions regarding flipped classroom, sir. Basically, the content which you told about prerequisite, I am following since last 4-5 years. Every lecture, I before this pandemic also, I used to give a brief prerequisite to the students so that they have a clear brush up in their mind. But sir, something I wanted to know about flipped classroom. How can we take the maximum advantage of flipped classroom, sir, and what are the easy ways that students get acquainted with it?
Yes, sir. I think you have missed my this starting session, inaugural session, wherein I gave you an overview of the course. So we have kept one full session on flipped classroom tomorrow at 10 o'clock.
Yes, sir.
Wherein the concept, the rules, the methodology will be discussed.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure. Yeah. Okay, sir. Fine. I'll be on that session. And sir, one more thing, I'll just like to give an update. Morning also, I requested the same. This is around my 6th FDP in NIIITT Chandigarh, and I am very much thankful to the team for organizing such wonderful sessions. especially director sir, Professor Patnaik. His session was also very fruitful. Basically, I am trying to just imply all those techniques in the currently going on online session, because nowadays students are not able to come to college. So this NITTR Chandigarh takes a great initiative in bringing up the recent topics, which may be helpful to budding faculties like us, who are having less than 10 years of experience. So a very big thank you to you, sir, especially NITTR Chandigarh team and Amandeep ma'am also for organizing all in a fruitful manner, sir. Looking forward to attending more sessions.
Thank you very much. So yes. One request to all the participating teachers, kindly be punctual, try to attend the session on right time. So the next session is at 2:30 p.m. So I request all the teachers to join by 2:20 so that the session could end at the right time only. Okay. So with these words, I thank you very much, and let us have a break, lunch break, and we'll join at 2:20 for a session at 2:30.